Hi, and welcome to Comicast, the podcast that talks about the issues that matter to you. This is the second part of our little podcast series on public ownership. Here we're going to look at public ownership in the face of state monopoly capitalism and beyond that point. Now, in the last episode, we talked about the history of public ownership in the UK and some of the lessons learned therefrom. Here, informed by those lessons, we're going to look to the future. Firstly, under our current political system, that of monopoly capitalism, aided and abetted by the state, how far public ownership can nonetheless be fought for and developed in ways that can better serve the interest of working people. Then we go on to consider the opportunities and challenges that open up under socialism after working people have secured the state power. Now, all this poses huge economic and philosophical questions, but anybody who said it would be easy clearly hasn't been paying attention. And anyone who thinks the supposedly free market can get us out of all this safely has been paying attention to the alternative fact sheets. So once again, it's a good job we have John Foster and Rob Wilkinson here to help us out with all of this. Before we begin, gentlemen, let's do some quick introductions. John, a very quick introduction to yourself, please, sir.
Well, I'm a retired academic. I was International Secretary of the Communist Party for 20 years, between 2002 and 2021. And I have been a branch secretary for up to the last 50 years, I think, in the Communist Party in some capacity or other in various parts of Britain.
Okay, John, thank you very much indeed. And Rob, over to yourself. A quick introduction, please.
Okay, thank you, Stuart. I've been a teacher for 40 years in a large comprehensive school, teaching a whole range of subjects at advanced level, economics being one, business studies, sociology, psychology, British government and politics, and actually rose through the union, the National Union of Teachers, to become a member of the National Executive of the National Union of Teachers, and still involved with the local National Education Union here in Oxfordshire.
Rob, I'm going to stick with you and ask you the first question. What do you think is the main purpose of public ownership under capitalism? And how do you relate that back to the party's program, the Communist Party of Britain's program, Britain's Road to Socialism?
Public ownership is back on the political agenda now because of the utter failure of the privatized utilities to serve the rest of society. Not just the individual consumer, but also the private enterprises that depend upon the delivery of basic services to ensure their effective and profitable existence. Many small and medium enterprises are under enormous pressure, and even the large companies are aware that they are being made to suffer by the ideological commitment of the government to privatization. Public ownership can therefore be seen as a benefit to the rest of society, capitalists as well as workers. A further benefit can be the restoration of political control over the utilities, rather than the motivation of short-term profit seeking. Capital investment is often required to take a longer view than that of the shareholder, and may even result in losses that a government can sustain better than the stock market. Other political considerations may be the environmental impact of such large-scale operations. Private businesses has been able, by and large, to dismiss their environmental consequences as externalities, unless constrained by the government to pay a high price for doing so. Public ownership can be more easily required to conform to these environmental expectations. Consumers also now have higher expectations of the technical and innovative specifications, and as such, the product and services provided is more open to pressure in this respect. Finally, the workers in public enterprises may be better organized and socially conscious of their impact upon the consumer and the environment and demanding better working conditions in carrying out their duties. This is already evident in the NHS and the education service. In line with the Communist Party programme, Britain's Road to Socialism, it has been substantial progress that an increasing number of trade unions and their members have taken up the demand for the restoration of public ownership and control. It was significant that the issue was under consideration by the Labour Party in their 2017 and 2019 election manifestos. And this needs to be built on in order to generate a paradigm shift, as some people call it, in public attitudes that cannot be ignored by politicians, both local and national.
Thanks, Rob. Yeah, paradigm shift in attitude is something that we'll talk about a little bit later. If I can just say as well here, we're currently looking at a large number of people and indeed small industries being shafted, there's no other word for it, by extremely expensive utilities prices. At a time whenever British Gas is owner Centrica has announced a significant increase in profits and profit expectations at the upper end of expectations. So public ownership could certainly contribute towards keeping those prices down. Okay, John Foster, over to you, sir. What's your response to this?
I think we have to face the fact that other things being equal, any state-controlled institution under capitalism will tend to operate to sustain capitalism itself. And in the past, we have certainly seen in this country public ownership used to subsidize the private sector, to hold down wages, and enable the covert production of subsidized exports. And unless challenged, capitalism will always be dominant within our state institutions. And this should remind us of Connolly, James Connolly's dictum, that unless it has the power of the industrial union behind it, democracy enters the state like a victim enters the gullet of a serpent. However, Connolly was not rubbishing democracy here. The key word is unless. Unless there is a mobilized working class, then it will be capitalism that will win and democracy that will be frustrated. So the question is, how can public ownership help to change the balance for workers if there is a mobilized working class that indeed does support the institution of public ownership? And I think we can list them. And we've already had a reference to the power industry. It can stop what's happening today, with an essential industry being ripped off by externally controlled investment banks and hedge funds. And the same would apply to key strategic industries needed for economic growth, where high levels of R&D and investment are essential. And these are immediate issues in Britain because our R&D and level of investment in productive industry is internationally at a very low level and historically at a very low level because financialization, the ripping out of profits by the finance companies, has largely stopped growth and investment. It would, thirdly, allow effective regional planning, creating clusters of growth industries anchored regionally and providing markets for smaller firms, enable a coordinated approach to energy conservation and the green agenda, and act as a stabilizer within the economy to sustain full employment and hence the bargaining power of organized labor. And these are the reasons why the left does rightly back public ownership within capitalism. And it's also why, in general, those representing the banks and finance capital don't, unless they can benefit in some way, as we've explained. The key question is, therefore, how to sustain that power of a mobilized working class and its impact on governmental institutions. And I think the Communist Party's position is that at the heart of any such movement, there has to be a core of trade unionists and labor movement activists who understand these issues politically. Politics is key. And its arms and legs, what moves it, must be the organized workforce in trade unions, tenants' associations, mobilized communities. And it needs also democratic institutions that can reflect the will of the majority and not easily be controlled by the capitalist state. And this is something our rulers know. It is why over the past 40 years, we have seen democracy under such attack. Local government has been robbed of any real economic powers. The Scottish and Welsh governments have suffered similarly. And it's also why the Party of Working People, the Labour Party, has always been such a battleground. And to counter this, it's why today the Communist Party calls for a broad popular front of social forces led by the organised working class that can fight back to recapture our representative institutions for democracy. Unless that's done, public ownership cannot be organised and run in a way that meets the needs of working people and indeed the wider community as a whole. That the battle of democracy is absolutely crucial, and that's real democracy in which the majority of the population, working people, are able to achieve what they want for the future. And it's a matter of ensuring that our institutions do indeed enable that. And we should remember the way workers in the past fought for the democratization of local government in the 1910s and 20s. Popular councillors in London spent months in jail, and so did councillors elsewhere, fighting for the rights of councils to give proper relief to the unemployed. And in the 1970s, it was the trade union movement that led the struggle for national governments in Scotland and Wales, for institutions that could directly reflect the interests of working people in terms of industrial policy. And it's also why the battle for democracy in the Labour Party has been a constant one throughout the last century. In current circumstances, we need to fight to recover the original powers of local government so that community wealth and power building can become a force for working people, using councils' procurement powers to take services in-house and develop its own provisioning of food, power, housing, and do so locally, and mobilize people to protect them politically. This is the basic level, in fact, of public ownership. It's also why we need a democratic restructuring of regions in England to provide powers over industrial policy and the defence of employment and powers restored in Scotland. Regions and nations are the key levels of economic and industrial planning. It's also why we need a radically democratised parliament, a lower house elected by proportional representation and reflecting overall needs, including wealth redistribution at British level, and a Senate to represent nations and regions. So before we can develop public ownership of a character that can defend the interests of working people, we also have to address these democratic issues that can enable the majority of working people to use their collective strength politically, democratically, to push aside what currently would be the dominant power of the capitalist state. A mobilised working class is absolutely essential.
Sure, and the regional issue is very important. Well, all of us here remember the 60s and the 70s, and the regional economic schools were important at the time. People talked a hell of a lot about regional disparities and what could be done about regional imbalances. I remember in the 70s, when I first started studying economics, reading about it a lot. Then it just seemed to disappear with the onrush of Thatcherism. So these regional disparities have an unbalancing effect on the entire economy, and it can give us or take us into self-perpetuating cycles of poverty that are tough to break. Now, the market hasn't fixed them. How do you think public ownership can make a difference here? And how does this tie into democratic reforms of our overly centralist government model, which, as we discussed already, are dominated by the interests of capital? Rob?
Nationalisation has been portrayed as public services run by unaccountable mandarins in Whitehall, remote from the concerns of ordinary people, including their own employees. This was never the whole truth, but the restoration of public ownership would enable us to seize the opportunity to establish a more democratic and accountable system of governance. Devolution of ownership and control should be at the lowest level possible to ensure effective operation and accountability. The devolved administrations at regional, county, district and parish level should be analysed as to which is best suited to operate and deliver services most effectively. However, the devolution of power may accentuate disparities between nations and regions, but it will bring ownership and control closer to the people. It must be accompanied with an oversight of central authority to distribute resources where they are most needed to ensure equity, if not equality. There will always be inequalities of natural resources, and technological developments may produce others as traditional industries decline and new ones require to be best located elsewhere. Transition must be handled sensitively to ensure that human resources are not wasted and put to better use by retraining and a system relocation. The transfer of financial resources will require a sophisticated assessment of needs and future potential. Once society can get away from the overriding demands of capital, the possibility exists for a better evaluation of how distribution can be organized to overcome poverty and social deprivation. We know as Marxists that dialectics reveals that nothing is static and unchanging, and only a political response is appropriate.
Thank you. John Foster, what's your take on the regional issue?
Well, I've already, I think, stressed the fact that public ownership can only deliver for the people if it is in touch and directly monitored by and influenced by the mobilized force of working people on the ground. But I want to say a bit about targeting. I don't think there was necessarily a lack of targeting in the past in Britain's nationalized industries, but it was often the wrong targets. It was cutting prices at the expense of investment to help the private sector. But there was sometimes the development of very useful targets. And I don't think we should forget what was achieved by Britoil and BNOC as set up by Tony Benn in 1974 and 75. It was between them the objective, the target to acquire both technological knowledge and market power, the same kind of technological knowledge and market power that Statoil in Norway enabled that country to use its oil in that sector of the North Sea to become an enormous fund of wealth and economic potential for the entire Norwegian economy. If we'd have done that today, we would be in quite different economic position. And it took Thatcher 10 years, in fact, to dismantle BNOC and Britoil. And we could also look on to other examples. But this is why a redemocratization of our political structures is so important.
Yes, yeah, a very important issue, and we'll stick some of the party's literature on progressive federalism up onto the website which accompanies this as well. And it's also very important to have local targets congruent with those which are imposed nationally. One issue can be if you get a bunch of local authorities anxious to attract industry, they get into the tax game, reducing local taxes. We don't want to do that. This has to be a proper integrated approach which works for everybody. You don't want regions competing with each other. That's a symptom of capitalism. Okay, let's now turn back to Rob. Now let's talk about public ownership as an argument for socialism in general. Lots of economic experts, the BBC and elsewhere, argue that it was public ownership and the lack of private enterprise and initiative, the usual here, that led to the failure of socialism and Russia in Eastern Europe, and some of the problems that they now have in places like China and Cuba. Basically, they'll say there's no competition and that takes away any inducement to improve, to innovate. Rob, what's your take on that?
The so-called failure of socialism in the USSR and Eastern Europe was more a political one than an economic. Although I agree with John, and targeting was probably something of an issue, in the sense of quantitative targeting was actually quite destructive of proper human social relationships. As any teacher will tell you, if quantitative targeting is the be all and end all of education, it's extremely destructive. And I think quantitative targeting in the USSR and Eastern Europe may well have been a problem. But on the other hand, their economies were still growing at a faster rate in general than those of Western Europe. And despite all the funding from international finance capital, since the restoration of capitalism in the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, millions of young people have been forced to emigrate as they had no future at home. That's not a healthy sign of a successful economy. If we compare Cuba with Puerto Rico, Haiti, and the Dominican Republic, its closest neighbors, as well as Jamaica, it's obvious which society is doing better for its people, despite the illegal US blockade. There had, in fact, been substantial innovation in the USSR during the 1930s that enabled the Soviet forces to defeat the fascist invasions with superior weaponry in tanks, artillery, machine guns, rocketry, whatever, and post-war in nuclear weapons and space exploration. And now China has grown so profoundly that it rivals the United States without requiring the exploitation of other countries for their natural and human resources. It's the political direction that is decisive.
Okay, thanks for that, Rob. Yeah, interesting you compare there Cuba to some of the other countries in the region. I was in Guatemala a good few years ago now, and I was talking to a pretty right-wing Guatemalan, and there aren't too many more right-wing than right-wing Guatemalans. And he said to me, in this country, if you get the cold, you can die. In Cuba, if you have a cold, you get seen straight away. And he's a big admirer of what Cuba had done. They also tend to admire even right-wing Guatemalans, anybody who stands up to the United States. And just before I call in John, I want to say too something interesting about targeting, I think, because targeting is very important. I was chatting to a student today who did, he's a young guy, just finished off his GCSEs, and he did Mandarin, which I think is pretty important for people in this country and elsewhere to learn Mandarin, because it's going to be a key language. Well, it is already. Did it at GCSE, did well. When it got to A level, and this is a fancy public school he goes to, or a private school, I should say, he was told he couldn't do Mandarin. Only native speakers were allowed to do Mandarin, because if he didn't get a good grade, it would affect the school's overall performance. So when you target people like that, targeting is all about driving the right behaviors. And that's something which is very important we have to think about. Anyway, John, over to you, sir. What's your take on the issue?
Well, I think Rob has said almost all the points I wanted to make about the Soviet Union and the socialist countries. The Soviet Union was, in fact, amazingly successful, given all the obstacles it had to face. It had a four-year occupation by enemy powers after 1918, led by Britain. And again, just 19 years after the evacuation of those forces, it had a Nazi invasion. Yet nonetheless, it built industry and it won those wars because its industry was superior to that of the biggest industrial power at that time, Nazi Germany. In fact, between 1920 and the 1940s, the Soviet Union had the fastest industrial growth anytime, anywhere up to that point. That's not Soviet propaganda. These are the findings very recently of Robert Allen, professor of economic history at Oxford University. Nobody has seriously disputed them. And it's, as Rob said, absolute nonsense to say that they were not able to innovate. How else did the Soviet Union manage to beat the United States in the space race in the 1950s and 60s? It needed to have the leading edge in a whole range of very complex technologies to do that. At the time, nobody else had them. The Americans didn't have them. The Soviet workers and technicians developed them. And even in terms of industrial organization, they were highly innovative. You hear about the Japanese just-in-time system being an extremely efficient method of organizing certain types of production. But in fact, that system was developed during World War II by the Soviet Union, adopted by them afterwards, incorporated in industrial management manuals, and it was these manuals that were later copied by the Japanese. And of course, as Robert said, the Soviet Union did not collapse economically. Growth decelerated in the 1970s and particularly in the 1980s to the rate of West Germany. In 1986-87, West Germany's rate of economic growth was roughly that of the Soviet Union. And it decelerated the Soviet Union largely because it was spending 17% of its GDP on defense in face of Reagan and Thatcher's second Cold War. But it's also correct to say that under these pressures, the level of working class political mobilization declined, and I think we'll need to come back to those issues later on in this podcast.
Yeah, we certainly will. Interesting, in 1983, the CIA did a survey looking at the comparative diets of the average Soviet citizen versus the average American citizen. And they concluded that the diet and how much people ate was about the same, although the Soviet diet was probably slightly more healthy. And that was in 1983. You certainly can't imagine that comparison being so favorable had the Tsars remained in power. Right, John, let's stick with you here. Next question is going to be about basically how within socialism, how do we ensure once we've defeated capitalism, a balance between the needs of the whole community and the legitimate interest of workers, in particular socialist enterprises, to secure the best outcomes for themselves, the families and the local community? Who's going to make the key strategic decisions? To whom will they be responsible? And in turn, to whom will that group of people answer to?
The Soviet economic system sought to balance the direction of its economy through a central plan and through the initiative of individual enterprises, through competitive emulation. And that was strengthened by a bonus system. And as noted earlier, for the first 40 years, this system worked very well indeed, and enormous difficulties were overcome. But nonetheless, later, there was a degree of decline, and the economy did slow down. And it was not just because of the pressure of defense spending. There were also more fundamental issues, and it's worth perhaps talking about them. They were essentially political issues, and they were raised by Soviet sociologists and politicians in the 1970s, and very pointedly by Yuri Andropov when he became president, a general secretary of the party in 1982, when he talked about alienation being an issue that needed to be addressed, and that the norms of Leninist democracy needed to be recovered and redeveloped. And that was a political task for the Communist Party. Unfortunately, it wasn't carried through in the right way later on, and I might come into discussion on that issue later, but I'll hand over now to Rob.
Thanks, John. The question of balance was certainly a serious problem in Yugoslavia after the break with the socialist community. And in many ways, it affected the development in some of the people's democracies, certainly Hungary and Poland, where the communist leadership was relatively weak and divided. But in the end, the issue can only be resolved by political leadership and the growth of socialist consciousness. The role of a communist party guided by Marxism-Leninism will certainly be required for a lengthy period of time and not assumed to be able to wither away. Building socialism is not without contradictions and class struggle, required against sectionalism, narrow sectoralism, whatever we decide to call it, and reactionary ideology. Socialist society will inherit all kinds of negative ways of thinking that can give rise incessantly to individualism and the seeking of ways to achieve immediate gratification without due considerations for wider society, the environment, and future generations. Socialist construction, both in material and social terms, requires a political direction that at times has to take a step back, necessary to make further progress possible.
We could do a whole podcast, and maybe at some point we should, about why the Soviet Union fell. I think it's worth noting as well that a certain dependence on oil and gas had built up, and modern day Russia does suffer from similar problems. So diversity is important. And it was also important to Cuba as well. But again, that's a whole different podcast. Okay, gentlemen, John, you mentioned this earlier. Andropov talked about problems of alienation in Soviet society and the need to go to restore the norms of Leninist working class democracy. What does that actually mean, and how do we ensure that we achieve that goal when we build socialism in the UK?
Well, I think the first part of that question is easier than the second part.
Yeah.
How do we define it? Well, I think the first thing to say is that it is a matter of politics above all. And we have problems emerging. I think they're not just in the Soviet Union. I think in all socialist countries, as the revolution moves on from the generations, first and second generations that made and then defended the revolution, and then the third and fourth generations that come after. Both Marx and Lenin made very similar points about revolutions. They're something we should bear in mind. They are mass events. They have to be mass events. They demand many people doing many things in a new way, but an organized way and with a perspective. And that mass action transforms people. And to be successful, a revolution must do this as a continuing process over the following years. If we want to think of a smaller scale example, we could instance in our country and in our experience some of the major strikes, some of the great successful strikes, as those in, say, the early 70s or those in the 1920s, that transformed generations and really bound together a labor movement with a perspective of what it wanted to do. Now, that's what revolutions do. Both Marx talked about revolutions in that way, and so did Lenin, that they are needed in order to transform people, to build collectivism, to build a new psychology. And the problem is, how do you sustain this in the long run? And that's what Yuri Andropov was, I think, referring to. How do you regain those norms of Leninist democracy? And it was, in fact, in the Soviet Union, a failure to resolve this challenge that enabled a section of the party's top leadership to back the restoration of market competition in 1988. Not all of them saw the results immediately. They didn't necessarily see that they were dismantling socialism, although one or two probably of traitors did indeed see that. But nonetheless, that was the result. It wasn't done without opposition. There were very significant forces within the Communist Party, and in particular, there were a number of key ones in Politburo. They were defeated, but nonetheless, they had a perspective. One was the trade union leader, Gennady Yanayev, who later became vice president of the Soviet Union in the last period in 1990, who had a perspective of how you'd redevelop Leninist working class democracy at the base. It's an interesting thing to go back to. He argued that you'd restore that progressive dialectic in the workplace by a creative conflict between trade unions and party cadres, a conflict that was of a creative character that carried things forward. And it was to be how a workplace met both its own and society's wider social needs. It balanced the material benefits for workers with the trade unionists and trade unions in the plant seeking to develop the cheapest possible production methods within a system in which they would be rewarded for producing goods with a stable price that costs less, but in face of a party branch, party cadres, that will be seeking to enhance quality, to protect quality, and to meet the wider needs of society and to develop new ways of meeting them. So there would be a creative conflict, maybe an intense one on occasion, within each individual workforce. That was what he was arguing as the way forward for a left perestroika, as he described it, in the late 1980s. You can actually read a transcript of his proposals in Communist Review for 2004. So I think the key point is that it was primarily a political contradiction and not an economic one, although they cannot be disentangled and their resolution demands an understanding of both. It certainly should not divert us from the overall strength of socialism on the one hand and the economically destructive character of capitalism, which we can see about us today, and the need within our own society at the moment to mobilize politically against it, to campaign for a redemocratization of institutional structures, and at the same time to fight to win an understanding and a mass understanding, and it is developing as we speak here, of the nature of monopoly capitalism, of the destructive character of the great monopolies that control what should be our public industries, and around that to regalvanize a trade union movement and a wider popular support that can indeed take us forward towards both new and reformed institutions that are democratic and on that basis effective public ownership, and a public ownership that, to be ultimately successful, has to dispense with the monopolized, financialized structures of capitalism that currently strangle our society.
Right, I think you did a pretty good job answering that very difficult second part of the question, but I can see a whole couple of other podcasts arising from this. This is a huge issue. And I certainly like the idea of that kind of creative tension in the workforce, because the key thing there is the workers are participating in what happens to them. It's not just imposed from above. Of course, there's going to be tension. There's going to be arguments. It's important to do that because we all grow from debate. And again, there's issues regarding targeting here as well, which are very important to look into in the future. Too much to talk about here. Rob, over to you. What's your take on this, please?
We have to accept that there is still a need for material incentives at the individual and collective level during the period of the construction of socialism. Experience has taught us that. There is no escape from the fact that the production of certain goods and delivery of services, certainly personal services, can be more effectively organized at the level of small and medium enterprises for a considerable period of time. Yet this has to take place under a society committed to the development of an increasing social as well as socialist consciousness that exists under a political ideological direction. The Chinese party were guided by the principle of putting politics in command. Their slogan of serve the people doesn't deny, but requires emulation between individuals and a recognition of interdependence in order to succeed as part of a collective endeavor. Even the great labor hero Stakhanov, the Soviet hero of production, he broke records in production only because he had a supportive team behind him. But let's look at one issue that I think you raised, Stuart, about alienation. Alienation is basically a divorce between the producer and the product that is produced that belongs to the employer. The worker sells their labor time and not the product that is produced during that time. Division of labor, whilst increasing the productivity of the individuals organized in the productive process, increases that alienation and makes it more profound, as the individual cannot easily identify their contribution to the finished product or service, which always belongs to someone else. Capitalism itself recognizes this problem by devising schemes that purport to give workers ownership by ceremonies of rewards for outstanding achievement or service and celebrations of successes in accomplishment. Well, socialism can build upon these things in order to enable the worker to participate in the organization and management of the productive process, as well as in the rewards achieved by effective and constantly improving delivery. In addition, socialism enables the worker to become increasingly involved in public administration by accepting responsibilities on local, regional, and national representative bodies that organize society as a whole. Specialization may well be required for a considerable period of time, yet become increasingly dissolved as educational standards improve alongside a developing political consciousness. Andropov understood the need to connect the party more intimately with the people, but possessed a sense of political direction and leadership that was sadly lacking in his successor. The form with Gorbachev might be similar, but the content was heading in the opposite direction, the wrong direction, as we now can see very, very clearly.
Indeed, and the whole concept of alienation is pretty central to Marxism, and we can debate the relative importance of the economic and philosophical manuscripts of 1844 to what Marx became later, but it's an extraordinary piece of work that everybody should read. Rob, let's stick with you very quickly. Give us some closing remarks there, sir.
Well, I think thanks to do to you, Stuart, for getting this podcast organized, even if it felt like you were herding cats at times. And I hope that our discussion will entice listeners to study the writings of Marx and Engels on the transition from capitalism to socialism, with the ultimate goal of a fully communist society. My recommendation would be to study Engels' Socialism, Utopian and Scientific, and Marx's Critique of the Goethe Program, for a deeper appreciation of what needs to be done. So let's get to it.
Excellent. There's going to be a very long reading list to go along with this podcast. Okay, John, okay, your closing remarks, please, sir.
Yes, it has been, I think, a very interesting podcast and exchange of opinions. And I think it has focused on the need to be relatively humble as people living in Britain, and to study the experience of those who have attempted to build socialism. We've looked at Cuba, we've looked at the Soviet Union, we've looked at China, we could have looked at Vietnam. All of these countries have their own particular achievements. They have all been through revolutionary processes. Just think of what Vietnam went through in order to achieve its liberation. And they have all developed institutions that have managed to, in one way or another, carry that through forward into third, fourth generations with greater or less success. When you look at the Soviet Union and some of the other countries that existed in Eastern Europe, but nonetheless, making even so great contributions to world liberation in terms of overcoming colonialism and destroying fascism and Nazism. We need to look back into those achievements and study them in detail. There is an enormous richness so that we can ourselves learn and apply, because the future does not lie in capitalism. It doesn't lie in reformism. It lies in the future of the working class and its allies in transforming our society and building a society in which we can move forward, overcome the immediate and desperate problems of climate change, and work to overcome, as Robert has talked about, the alienation that is implicit in capitalism, and build a society in which everybody understands their role in creating the collective wealth.
Absolutely, and it is massively important. You have to understand history to be able to understand and transform the present. Conrad, thanks very much indeed. So it's clear the struggle isn't over with the elimination of capitalism. There's going to be issues how the new public entities are managed, how their objectives and their management can dovetail with agreed economic priorities and plans, and also how the public entities can repurpose economic activity and our attitudes to that activity. This can't just be about a bunch of unrelated state-run companies looking to maximize the accumulation of capital and exploit their monopoly power. This has to be about offering people the chance of a fulfilled and varied working life in a system and a society not based on exploitation. This has been Comicast. We are anti-fascist, anti-racist, anti-imperialist, but very much pro the working class. Thank you very much for listening.